Sam had lost his mother, had lost his father, had lost his siblings, and found himself living alone, and he bounced around from one extended family member to another because they didn't want him. They called him terrible names. I can't even repeat how awful these names were. Finally, he did find a cousin that he could live with. In Uganda, they call him sister. I believe she was a cousin, but she was just a child herself. And he found access to medication at a clinic in Kampala in the city. Now, this was not antiretroviral therapy. This was not life-saving medication, but they could treat some of his symptoms. But he had to walk a long ways to get there. It was a free clinic on Friday, every Friday. He'd make that long walk every Friday he was there to see this doctor who was kind to him and took care of him. But then one Friday he didn't show up, and then another Friday he didn't show up. And so the doctor became worried and went looking for him and found this little house where this other young person was living. And she said, oh, he was getting so sick, and we knew he was going to die. So we took him to the village so he could die from there. You see, in Uganda, there aren't really cemeteries. People are buried out in the village near their ancestral home. And oftentimes, if they feel someone is dying, they take them there because it's more expensive to transport a dead body than it is to transport a living body. So imagine being a little boy and being told you're taken, literally taken to the graves because you're going to die. Aid Child is an organization that cares for orphans living with AIDS in Uganda, East Africa. And it was the first organization to provide free antiretroviral therapy for children in Uganda. And it was among the first in the world to do that. I founded the organization nearly 12 years ago. And the organization earns 70% of its own budget through businesses that we started under its corporate label in Uganda as well. So that's a really unique part of this endeavor where we're helping children, but the first to really provide this sort of an intervention, and at the same time we earn so much of our own income. I say we because it's not me alone. Well, Sam had so much hope and so much determination that he hitchhiked, he did everything he could to get back to the city, back to that doctor, and then she brought him to us. And three nights later, in the middle of a very dark night, the power was out, the nurse was making her rounds in the middle of the night, and he woke up and he said, don't you see? God loves me so much. And she said, well, of course he does, but why are you saying that? And so he told her the story that I just told you. And then he said, don't you see? God loves me so much. This is my history, but this is my present. This is what I have. I have this clean bed. I have these new clothes. And now you're waking me up in the middle of the night to give me medication. Don't you see, God loves me so much. And you know, I've thought of that so many times. If that were my story, and I woke up on that dark night, I'm not sure my first thoughts would have been of a God who loves me. I think my first thoughts would have been all that I had lost, and the disease that I still had. And so the kids are always forward thinking and not backward thinking. And so those are the moments that we return to when we get to our smaller places of challenge.
Regrets collect like old friends. Here to relive your darkest moments. I can see no way, I can see no way. And all of the ghouls come out to play. And every demon wants his pound of flesh. But I like to keep some things to myself. I like to keep my issues drawn. It's always darkest before the
seen the rawness of life. I think oftentimes we are so protected from the rawness of life. And not all rawness is bad. I mean, there's raw beauty, there's raw compassion, there's raw joy, there's raw gratitude. And I think often in my own culture, we shy away from that rawness. We put those things away. But I've also been exposed to the rawness of very terrible, horrible things that should never have been. And so balancing the dichotomy of those things has fundamentally changed who I am. In some ways for the better, in some ways for the worse, I think. But I know that I'm stronger, and I know that I'm smarter and wiser.